In this video, we're going to learn more about modes of convergence. In the last video, we saw that bringing a measure gave us two new ways of measuring convergence. We saw L1 convergence and convergence pointwise almost everywhere. And now we're going to talk about two new ways, and those are convergence in measure and a sequence being Cauchy in measure. Before we start, let me remind you that if these videos are helpful, you can support us in a few different ways. You can donate on Ko-fi, become a member on Patreon, or support us by buying t-shirts, hoodies, stickers, and other things in our store. All the links are in the description of the video. Okay, so let's start. Convergence in measure is when we have a sequence, say fn, and we will say that it converges on measure mu to a function f. If for every epsilon greater than zero, the measure of the set of points for which the modulus or absolute value of the sequence in x minus the function in x is greater than epsilon, so we're just taking the measure of all the elements x for which our sequence is far away from our function. And what we want is for this measure to go to zero. So whenever this happens, we say that our sequence of functions converge in measure to our function f. So always remember that measures do not know what happens on sets that have small measure or measure zero. That brought us directly to the definition of convergence almost everywhere. But here what we're saying is all the points for which we don't have convergence is a set that's going to zero. We'll see in a minute what is the difference between these convergences and convergences almost everywhere. We also say that a sequence of functions, fn, is Cauchy in measure if the measure of all the points for which the sequence in the nth step at x minus the sequence in some other step m is greater than epsilon, if this measure goes to zero, and now when n and m both go to infinity. In this case, it was just for n going to infinity. So this is again very similar to convergence in measure, but this is just a characteristic that a sequence can satisfy. And the reason why it's called Cauchy in measure is because for our measure, the measure of the points where the sequence is not Cauchy is a set that has measure very, very small. So from the point of view of our measure, the sequence in this case is Cauchy. But this other definition of convergence in measure seems very similar to convergence almost everywhere. Because what we were saying is, well, our sequence converges everywhere except on a set of measure zero. So what's the difference? Let's write the definition of convergence almost everywhere. What we're saying is the measure of all the points where our sequence that does not converge is zero. So let's write the set. It's the set of all the points x for which the limit of fn of x is different than f of x. So we can say that the difference between these two things is, well, here I'm taking different and here I'm taking epsilon. But I could have stated this as saying, well, for every epsilon, just consider the measure of the set where fn of x minus f of x is greater than epsilon. What if I did this? Then now these two definitions seem very similar. So what is actually the difference between convergence almost everywhere and convergence in measure? The thing is right here. So in this case, in convergence almost everywhere, we have the limit inside the set that we're measuring. Whereas in convergence in measure, we first take the measure of the set and then here we take the limit. So that is why convergence almost everywhere is not the same as convergence in measure. In fact, if you go back to our previous video, we saw one example where we can prove that the sequence of functions converges in measure, but not almost everywhere. The example for this was when we took f1 of x to be the characteristic at 0, 1, f2 of x, the characteristic at 0, 1 half, f3, 1 half, 1. And now in the successive steps, we divide each of these into two more intervals. So we will have f4 is 0, 1 quarter, f5 is the characteristic in 1 quarter, 1 half, f6 is in 1 half, 3 quarters, and finally f7 is the characteristic in 3 quarters, 1, and so on. We now, in the following step, we will divide each of these four intervals into halves, and so that will give us the sequence. Now this sequence we showed in the last video that does not converge to zero pointwise almost everywhere, but we can show, and this is going to be an exercise, that it does converge to zero in measure. And so this immediately gives us that convergence in measure does not imply convergence almost everywhere. And of course, it will also not imply convergence pointwise everywhere or uniform convergence. Because if it did imply any of these two, then these two would imply convergence almost everywhere. And so we would have that convergence in measure would imply convergence almost everywhere. And so again, we have a new way of defining convergence that is kind of disconnected from the rest. And that was the conclusion that we got last video by studying convergence in L1 versus these three types of convergence. Well, let's see if convergence in measure is related to convergence in L1. And with this proposition, we can see that they are related. If we have a sequence that converges in L1 to F, then it will also converge in measure. So let's prove this theorem. The idea is we have the hypothesis that our sequence converges in L1, and we want to prove that it converges in measure. So what we want to do is calculate the measure of the set of x such that fn of x minus f of x is greater than epsilon. So let epsilon be some number greater than zero. We want to calculate this measure. And all we know is that our sequence converges in L1. So we know things about integrals. So how can we go from an integral to the measure of a set? Well, for notation purposes, let's call this set E n epsilon because it depends on n and on epsilon. And let's see what we have. From our hypothesis, we know that the integral of f of n minus f d mu, this goes to zero. And this integral is taking over the entire space x. Remember that every time we talk about measures, we are assuming that we're working on a set x with some sigma algebra m and a measure mu. So here we know that this integral over the entire space will go to zero. But integrating in the entire space is obviously greater than integrating on a subset. In particular, I can take the subset to be this one. And I will integrate the same thing, fn minus f. But now, when I'm integrating in this set only consists of all the x such that this difference is greater than epsilon. So, in this set, these functions satisfy this. So this is actually greater than integrating on this set epsilon. Now epsilon is just a constant, so I can just pull it out of the integral. And I'm integrating 1 on some set with respect to a measure. This is always the measure of the set. So that will be epsilon and the measure of the sets. So now remember that these sets were this, were the points where the sequence minus the function is greater than epsilon. So from this, we have that the measure of that set is smaller than, because of this, and I can move epsilon to the other side, and that will give me 1 over epsilon, the integral on the entire space of fn minus f. But now, since my sequence converges in L1, then I know that this integral, when n tends to infinity, and this is for a fixed epsilon, will just go to 0. So then the measure goes to 0. And so this gives immediately that the sequence converges in measure to the function. So we can now actually add something a bit positive here, and that is if the sequence converges L1 to F, then it does converge in measure. So now we have two definitions of convergence that are, or at least for now, seem to be disconnected from all the rest. But maybe this is not the case, and we will continue with this in the next video.